The task is that Nick was giving a talk about these right-angled groups, if you remember, that you know any chain has sublinear rank growth. And we got some grief about the name, okay? And I agree, it sucks. It's not a good name for that group. So I want you to name that notion. Find a good name for the notion. If you find an okay name, you get the cake. If you find a better name, you get €5. And if you find a really good name, you get the vine, okay? At the end of the talk. And you know, if I'm not happy, you won't get anything. So, okay, I'll tell you what it means, the notion. So what we are looking for, you have a discrete group gamma. And it happens so that there exists g1, g2, gn in gamma. They all have infinite order. And when you take the commuting graph, you draw the edge when they commute. So the commuting graph is connected, and they generate gamma. So my understanding is that this notion was first looked at by Damian, who proved that these guys have fixed price one, these groups. And then we named it right-angled groups. But I admit that that wasn't the most fortunate name. So invent a good name for it by the end of the talk. Actually, I did the same 4 years ago with the notion of IRS. This is when I got to this notion, and I gave a talk at Imperial College, and I made the audience give me names. And I have to tell you, I hope you're doing better than they were doing. So didn't help much, although some of the names were very funny. Okay, so. Yes.
Can we submit more than one name?
You mean, no, one name per person. Yeah. Especially you, you know. Okay. So, all right, guys. So let's do this. So the first thing is, it's a disclaimer. This is my second attempt in my life to give a projector presentation. Okay, in general, I don't really like these presentations. Whenever I see one, I feel like I'm in a movie. Okay. So if anyone has popcorn, give me some. And I made the same joke in my first presentation. I just had to copy it here, okay? And this is the problem with the projector presentations, okay? So, all right, so, okay. So what is an IRS? So it's a lot of material. Some pages I will just run through cruelly. If it's too fast, stop me, and I explain more. But you've heard this notion. So what is an invariant random subgroup? Take first a discrete group, then it can be a locally compact group. Take the set of subgroups of gamma and dye it with the product topology, inherited from 0, 1 to the gamma. This is called Schabauer topology. Okay, so this makes it into a compact space. The space of subgroups is compact. And gamma acts on the space of subgroups continuously by conjugation. Okay, very simple object. When you have a locally compact group, you have to consider closed subgroups so that this makes sense. But then it makes sense. So you have a compact set. You have a nice continuous action. And the next thing you're looking at is just an invariant measure on it. So an invariant random subgroup of gamma is a random subgroup of gamma whose distribution is an invariant measure under the conjugation action. All right? That's it. So we coined this name in this paper with Glasner and Virag. But you know, these guys have been around in various forms. There is this Mackey virtual group theory. Thank you. And measured groupoids. If you know what a measured groupoid is, you're not surprised by this notion. There is this Navos-Tuck-Zimmer theorem. There is the Bergeron-Gaboriau work. So they were kind of all around. And there is a parallel work, which is parallel to us, really happened at the same time, of Verschik on totally non-free actions. So you know, we coined the name. I definitely don't claim that we invented the notion of an invariant measure on a compact space. The new viewpoint that we brought into this will be apparent. So you will see what's going on. And you know, let's just connect it to one of the natural things. If you take a measure-preserving action of gamma, then if you take the stabilizer of a random point, this is an invariant random subgroup. This is trivial. because you sample from the space, and when you take the conjugate distribution, that means just sample it from the conjugate. I mean, you mix the space, but of course it's the same space with the same measure, so it's the same distribution. Okay, so that's an IRS, and there is a lemma in this starting paper with Glaser and Virag, is that actually every invariant random subgroup arises as a stabilizer of a measure-preserving action. So you can think of IRS-es as stabilizers of measure-preserving actions. Okay, so let me just list some of the general aspects. The rest of the talk will be kind of to outline what I mean here. So invariant random subgroups, first of all, they tend to behave like normal subgroups rather than arbitrary subgroups. So this means if you have a theorem that holds for normal subgroups but does not hold for general subgroups, then you have a very good chance that it holds for invariant random subgroups. Okay? You have to prove it, and the proof is usually different than the proof for normal subgroups, but I've never seen a counterexample to this phenomenon, so somehow it inherits normal subgroups. This phenomenon was actually already pointed out by Bergeron, Gaborio, that they look at stabilizers of measure-preserving actions. Okay, they comment that it looks, you know, it behaves like a random subgroup, and you will see many examples of that. So that's one cool thing about them. The second thing is that, you know, for locally compact groups, usually normal subgroups don't make sense because they don't have. Often for interesting locally compact groups, they don't have normal subgroup. But every lattice gives rise to an invariant random subgroup because you take a lattice in your locally compact group, you know, it has finite covolume, so you can take a random conjugate. Okay, and that's an invariant random subgroup. And in some circumstances, it goes backwards. Every invariant random subgroup is actually coming from a lattice. So the new viewpoint that we brought into this stuff that I've never seen anywhere else is weak convergence of IRS-es. Once you think about this object, as a random subgroup, weak convergence is the most natural thing to study. And that's actually how we got into this notion. We come from graph convergence. And I wanted to understand what an invariant random Shire graph is. This is how I got to this notion. So what happens is when you take the set of invariant random subgroups is a compact space, and then with respect to weak convergence, and weak convergence translates to Benjamini-Schramm convergence of the quotient spaces. Okay, you will see what this means. I mean, we will have two examples for that. And the other thing is that weak convergence tends to carry over spectral information, spectral measure, L2-Betti numbers, Poincaré measure, everything that's spectral, it tends to behave nicely with respect to that. And there are some things that where we know that it behaves nicely with respect to convergence. There are some things where we conjecture. And so there's a lot of open questions. So the question, first let's look at this Benjamini-Schramm convergence. So fix your favorite compact space. It could be a complex, a Riemannian manifold, you name it. Okay? And take the fundamental group pi 1. Okay? The question is, how do you approximate the universal cover? The universal cover is a very useful object, right? And you want to approximate it with compact covers. There are many reasons why you may want to approximate it. One reason is that the universal cover may be a beautiful object, and you want to gather information from that infinite object down to the finite one. Okay? Another reason may be that the universal cover is an ugly object or a non-existing object. For example, if you have an affine variety, the universal cover is not an affine variety, so you kind of want to converge to it, but never reach it, and still do math, you know, and kind of talk about it as a virtual object up there. This is a big industry. So anyways, this is something that people want or do. And the usual solution, the orthodox solution, is you take pi 1, you take a chain of normal subgroups of finite index, okay? I mean, with trivial intersection, assume that it exists. If it exists, you're happy. If not, you're not happy. And then take the corresponding covering tower. So you get a tower of coverings of these manifolds or spaces or actions or whatever. Does this make sense? And then, you know, then this will approximate the universal cover. Well, there are certain problems with that. You know, these guys are normal, and they form a chain. And this is, in many situations, this is not the natural thing you would do. For example, if you take SL to Z, then the stuff that number theorists like to look at is that they take it mod p, and they even take the they take this gamma 0 p. You know, they take the preimage of the upper triangulars. That's the object. These are not normal. They don't form a chain. And still, this is kind of the sequence they are really interested in. Okay, so it would be nice to have a convergence notion for those. And the last thing is that this is not a convergence notion. You take two covering towers, you cannot merge it. If you take it's not true that any sequence has a covering tower subsequence that is convergent in that sense. It's just an ad hoc notion. So this is where invariant random subgroup helps. So take a finite index subgroup. For a finite index subgroup, let the IRS of the finite index subgroup be a random conjugate of that finite index subgroup, okay? And then use weak convergence, so you say that a sequence of finite index subgroups is approximating if this sequence of measures weakly converge to the Dirac measure on 1. Okay? And that seems to be the good notion, the good approximating notion. Here it is a robust notion. Every sequence will have a convergent subsequence because the set of IRS's is compact. And you can merge stuff. It's a proper convergence notion. Sometimes the weak limit is not the trivial IRS. Then it's another invariant random subgroup of infinite index, and you can study that. So you can do analysis on it. All right? So this convergence notion is equivalent to local sampling convergence. This is what graph theorists call Benjamini-Schramm convergence. So that means that you have your sequence of spaces, and here you have the universal cover. This is Mn. And then this convergence translates to asking that if I fix some R and I take the R ball in the universal cover and I compare it to a random R ball in my models, then I shouldn't be able to distinguish them. So if I look at the distribution of R balls in a big model, then I cannot distinguish it. Probabilistically, I cannot distinguish it from the universal cover. Okay? So you know this notion. This is, Riemannian geometry. This is just called injectivity radius, if you want. It tells you that from most points, the injectivity radius goes to infinity in that manifold. Okay? And typically, I don't know many counterexamples. Whatever invariant is continuous for normal chains, it is expected to be continuous for this IRS convergence notion. So this gives rise to a lot of questions, actually. Okay, so let's have an example. This is the so-called Luke approximation theorem. So BK is the kth Betti number, zero characteristic, and beta K is the kth L2 Betti number. And the Luke approximation theorem just says that if you take a finite complex, and you take a sequence of subgroups which approximates the group so that the corresponding IRS is weakly converged to the trivial IRS, then for all k, the normalized Betti numbers converge to the L2 Betti number of the universal cover. Okay? That's the theorem. This was proved by Luc for normal chains with trivial intersection. Then Farber wrote a nice paper where he defined a notion for chains that is exactly this IRS convergence. It's a special case of the IRS convergence. Then Bergeron and Gaboriau did the theory for any chain, arbitrary chains. Of course, for an arbitrary chain, these guys will not converge to the trivial one. They will converge to some other IRS. So you have to invent a notion of relative L2 Betti numbers relative to an IRS. And this is possible, and the convergence theorem works. And this was done by Nicolas and Damien. Okay, so for chains, and it just works for IRSs. You never have to assume that it's a chain. Okay, the same theorem works, and really, kind of, this is really the proof of Luke. I mean, you use pointwise as weak convergence of spectral measure. You just use it in different categories. Okay, so I attribute it to Luke. Actually, he has a beautiful lemma that takes care of it, basically. After all the translations, okay? And also, Damien has this beautiful work on L2 Betti numbers of equivalence relations. I'm sure you're familiar with it. And you can introduce a notion for non-free actions also. You can introduce L2-Betti numbers for non-free actions. And then his theorem kind of translates to say that it only depends on the IRS. You know, if you have same group, two actions with the same stabilizer structure, then this relative L2-Betti numbers will be the same. Okay. So, okay, this Luc approximation theorem, it's a beautiful theorem, it's open for infinite index IRS's. We don't know that it converges, okay? It's open for mod p Betti numbers instead of q Betti numbers. We don't even know what that limit would be. That's one of the major difficulties. This is a von Neumann dimension, that stuff. The L2-Betti number is a von Neumann codimension, and we don't have the corresponding notion for mod p. This doesn't exist. And it's open for minimal number of generators. We know that the normalized, you put minimal number of generators instead of bk, right? And then.
But do you know that mod p Betti number, take even two, the most simplest case to take two normal chains?
We don't even know that they converge for normal chains.
And you don't know that they will be equal?
No. Nothing. You know nothing there.
There are some results on that, yeah.
Some results, some nice results, but it's very far from, you know, they are very special cases. So, yes. No, this is an open problem. So, if you look at the rank, the minimal number of generators, we know that it converges on chains. Nick already told you the proof, and it's a simple proof. But we don't know whether it depends on the chain, whether the growth, this rank gradient depends on the chain. So the general question is whether it's kind of continuous in this IRS topology. That's what's really going on. We don't have a counterexample. This is very much connected to the fixed price problem of Damian. So I'm not going to go into cost now because I don't have time for it. I'm just pointing it out. Okay, so here come Sophie groups. I hope you know what a Sophie group is because this is a kind of a desperate definition. That's the point. I mean, I would have to write up a lot of things. So Sophie group is something where the Cayley graph can be approximated by finite structures. Anyways, let me read it. So a group is Sophie. You know what Sophic is, right? Right? Talk to me, guys. What?
It's a Benjamini-Schramm into finite dots.
Finite Schramm graphs. Yeah. No, it's not the same. Anyways, here is just a reformulation. So you know the Sophic story. The reformulation is kind of interesting, although I could never use it for anything. So this is that you take a presentation of the group. So take gamma, realize it as free group over a normal subgroup, and then you ask whether in the free group, the Dirac measure on the normal subgroup is the weak limit of finite index IRS's. Okay, so that's the same as Sophic. This is the same as Sophic. It's a clean definition because there are no epsilons. At least they are hidden. And that's kind of a natural thing to look at. Not only this is not so, no one knows a group that is not Sophic, but there is the generalized Sophic question, which is the Aldous-Lyons question. Is every IRS in a free group, can you obtain it as a weak limit of finite index IRSs? Okay, so even this is open. We have different beliefs. I think Aldous and Lyons even proved it at some point that it is. However, turned out that it's not a proof. So, okay. So let me tell you, so this was more like, so far these were like kind of reformulations except this Luc approximation theorem. So let me tell you a theorem. Which kind of tells you it's a good example for saying that IRS's behave like normal subgroups. Okay, so take a deregular graph. For a deregular graph, the spectral radius is the norm of the random walk operator on the graph. When it's finite, you omit the trivial eigenvalues. Okay, and something is Ramanujan if it has best possible. If its spectral radius is less than the spectral radius of the deregular tree of the universal cover. So this is Kasten's thesis, actually, PhD thesis. That's what he proved. Take a group generated by a subset, finite subset, and take a normal subgroup of infinite index. Then the spectral radius of the quotient group increases compared to the spectral radius of the original group if and only if the normal subgroup is non-amenable. So if you factor out by non-amenable, it really bites into the spectral radius. You will see it. The random walk will feel it. And amenables, you won't feel it. Okay? So this theorem is a typical theorem that is true for normal subgroups. That's not the form usually people know this. This has two corollaries, and usually people know the two corollaries, but not this general form. Anyways, that's what he really proved. And this is not true for subgroups. Is it to produce counterexamples for subgroups? A subgroup can be non-amenable and still very small. But it's true for invariant random subgroups. This is the theorem with Glasner and Virag. Same theorem. Take a symmetric generating set, take an IRS of infinite index, then the quotient Schreier graph increases the spectral radius if and only if, well, doesn't increase the spectral radius if and only if the subgroup, this random subgroup, is almost surely amenable. Okay? So you have to be a bit more careful because it's a random object now. Does this make sense? At this point, I have to ask you, how is the movie watching going? Are you like dazed or can you pay attention? I really don't know. You're smiling because I'm asking something. What? Okay, this was my challenge for myself today. You know, I make this presentation. I mean, joking aside, the problem with presentation is that you're not so present. It's a question of presence, right? So I challenge myself to kind of fight and be present here. So you have to be present here too, or you're all thinking about how to name that group, right? Okay, so. Yeah. Okay. So take this thing, just believe it. And now it's an exercise and you could do it, and we if we had more time I would let you do it. Free groups do not admit amenable IRS's. If you have an amenable IRS in a free group, then it's one. It's the trivial group. So why? Because amenable means cyclic, and there are only countable in many cyclic subgroups of the free group, so you cannot put an invariant measure on them meaningfully. That's it. Okay? So there are no amenable IRS's in the free group. This means that in a free group, every IRS increases the spectral radius, the quotient spectral radius. So now we apply this on a theorem of Serre. So let's have this corollary first. So the corollary is, take the spectral measure of a finite graph, okay, eigenvalue distribution, actually, okay, and then it tells you, This corollary tells you that if you take a finite d-regular graph with size tending to infinity, and the limit of the spectral measure is supported on the minimal possible interval, okay, so all those jelly is squeezed inside in the limit in the spectral radius of the tree, then actually the graph sequence converges to the tree. There are few cycles, which means exactly that we know what that spectral measure is. The spectral measure is the Kesten-McKay measure of the tree. Okay? So this is a rigidity theorem, if you want. You have this eigenvalue distribution. You try to massage it inside with finite graphs, try to massage it inside its minimal bounds. Then it takes a fixed shape. Okay? That's the result. And I will prove you this result using the IRS stuff in a minute. But let's see the corollary first. So this is a theorem of Serre. He doesn't count L cycles, he counts the number of primitive cyclically reduced cycles. Anyways, it's just a kind of a reformulation. And then he proved this theorem that if the density of those primitive, if you have a graph sequence and the density of those primitive cycles converges and they don't grow too fast, okay, if they have a radius of convergence, you know, square root of d minus 1, okay, that's what's written there, okay, then he proves that the limit of the spectral measures exists, and it's absolutely continuous, and it's supported on this interval, on the minimal possible interval, okay? So he proved that it's absolutely continuous, and actually, by our corollary, you know, there is this exciting class of measures, right? A priori, it's just that they don't exist. Okay, so all of it is just the spectral measure of the tree. This is the corollary. It turns out that, you know, if the Serre condition holds, then all the gamma k are zero, actually. And you know, and then this limit, we know what this limiting measure is. This limiting measure is the spectral measure of the tree. So you don't catch interesting fish in that universe. You're trying to push in the spectral measure, you will know its shape. You will know the shape of the graphs even. Okay, so let's prove this. That's a good way to show how to use this IRS stuff. So you take this sequence of D-regular graphs, okay? So I only prove it for when D is even. That's just simpler, okay? When D is even, I can turn every finite D-regular graph can be turned into a Schreier graph for the free group. It's a cute combinatorics exercise. You have to use Eulerian cycles. Okay, so you label the edges and it becomes a Schreier graph for the free group, which means that you have a free group action on it and you can take the IRS of that action. Okay? Now assume that this theorem does not hold. That means that for some L, the ratio of L cycles will not diminish, right? So take a subsequential limit where the ratio of L cycles is more than some constant, and take even a subsequential limit of that where the corresponding IRS is converge, just compactness. Okay? So eventually you get a sequence of IRSs that weakly converge, and the limit is not the trivial IRS because in the limit, this L cycle survives with positive probability. So you get a non-trivial IRS of the free group, hence, you know, it's non-amenable. And hence, by the Kasten theorem of IRSs, it bites into the spectral radius. Hence, these graphs couldn't be, the limit of these measures cannot be supported on the minimal interval. End of proof. Okay? So that's a typical compactness argument machine, you know, subsequential limits. So, okay. So the next theorem I want to tell you is probably the deepest theorem on invariant random subgroups so far. This is the Nevo-Stuck-Zimmer theorem. It's actually the story is that Stuck and Zimmer wrote a paper which was published in Annals. So it was an Annals paper, but it wasn't a theorem until Nevo and Zimmer wrote another paper. That's my understanding of the story. So, you know, I want to give credit to everyone involved. And so here is the theorem. That's not the way it was stated there, but it's really equivalent. And now I only state it for simple Lie groups because I want to avoid adding irreducibility and all that all the time. But you can do it, okay? So take a higher rank simple Lie group and then take an ergodic invariant random subgroup in it. If it's not trivial and it's not the whole G, then it's a lattice. It's a random conjugate of a lattice. Okay, that's what that theorem really says. Okay, so these guys have very, very few invariant random subgroups. All of them have finite index. Okay? What does this remind you of? It reminds you of the Margulis normal subgroup theorem, right? And of course it does, because the Margulis normal subgroup theorem follows this from this in one line. Okay, so this is the Margulis normal subgroup theorem. Of course, not in its full form, but never mind. Take a higher and simpler Lie group, take a lattice in it, and take a normal subgroup in it. In the lattice, then it has finite index. Okay, these are so-called just infinite groups. Well, why? Why does it imply? Well, take the normalizer of your normal subgroup in G. It's a lattice, right? So you can talk about a random conjugate of it. You can take, because the normalizer has finite covolume, you can take its random conjugate. It's an IRS, but there are no such IRSs. Every IRS has finite index. So this is kind of a clean Margulis normal subgroup theorem. It doesn't even talk about lattices to start with, just structure of invariant random subgroups. It's a nice reformulation, and actually this reformulation was very useful for us. So, okay, does this make sense? The same way you can prove that these lattices do not admit non-trivial invariant random subgroups. Same proof. You could induce it up to the Lie group, and that's not possible. Okay, those guys don't exist. Okay, this the theorem doesn't work for rank one. Well, the Margulis normal subgroup theorem already doesn't work very much. Doesn't work for rank one, and it works for semi-simple Lie groups. You have to add a lot of text, and I just don't do it now because I don't have time. It's very exciting math, but that's not where I'm going now. Okay? You have to make a lot of assumptions, and I don't want to go there. So there are new proofs now, and extensions are in the works by some young Israeli mathematicians, so we are looking forward to getting them on archive. Okay, so that's a hardcore theorem. It's a beautiful theorem, and it's very natural on this language. Okay, and reformulating it to this language, you will see that it's a useful thing. Let me mention, this will be a fast page. Maybe if I have time at the end, we'll come back to it. There are a lot of other nice stuff about IRS-es. So Verschik has this program of totally non-free action. He classified IRS-es for finitely symmetric group. It's a very nice theorem. Bao and Grigorchuk, Kravchenko work on showing, in a series of papers, showing zoos of IRS-es, that large groups admit many, many invariant random subgroups. And then there is this boundary thing. Maybe I get back to it, so I omit it now. There is a result of Kanizo and Kaimanovich on stationary random subgroups, where you don't want, it's just stationary. You don't want it to be invariant under the conjugation action, just under some random walk on the group. It should be stationary under a random walk. And still you can look at the Poisson boundary, and you can say things about the dynamics there. And there is the Glasner-Weiss paper which just came out. This is the older Glasner, Eli Glasner. They introduce a topological version of IRS, so no measure, and they introduce it as uniformly recurrent subgroup. It's a minimal subshift of the space of subgroups. Okay, and they prove some corresponding theorem. It's very interesting stuff. Okay, so the next thing is, this is the Seven Samurai, and there are the names. This is a courtesy of, it's not there anymore. So it was Nicolas who did this, not me. I have to add this because, I have the biggest head on the picture, so I have to add this disclaimer. It wasn't me. But if you've seen the Seven, who saw the Seven Samurais? What? Are you kidding? No. You're just sleeping. What? Well, look at it. It's a fucking great movie. Okay. Anyways, So I have to add that Nicolas was nice because he put me on the biggest guy, but that guy is the fool. I have to point out. He's the fool and he's killed, so thanks, Nicolas. Okay, so the story that I want to tell you is this result that big higher rank locally symmetric spaces are also fat. Okay? That's what we are going to prove. If you're a guy like me, you have to distinguish between big and fat. This is like, I'm like 110 kilos, so I have to at least tell myself that I'm big, not fat. Anyways, what do we mean by that? So the symmetric space is just the quotient of the Lie group by the maximal compact. And here is a nice theorem. So you have a notion of a locally symmetric space. Locally symmetric just means that you have this space. You have this symmetric space X, which is G mod K. And then you look at some other space such that for every point, there exists some Riemannian manifold. For every point, there exists some neighborhood which is isomorphic to the ball here. This is a homogeneous space. Okay? So this is a locally symmetric space. Of course, this epsilon may depend on the point. Okay? And the nice result here, that's an ancient result. I don't even know who to attribute it to. If you have a connected, complete, locally X space, then it's just a quotient of X by a lattice. Okay? So it's covered. The universal cover will be this beautiful space. So talking about locally symmetric spaces is the same as talking about coverings from the symmetric space. So here the corresponding notion that you want to look at is this injectivity radius. So it asks you how far you have to look to distinguish it from the symmetric space at a certain point. That's the injectivity radius. And now I just define the R-fin part of a locally symmetric space. There's a set of points where the injectivity radius is less than R. Does this make sense? That's where it's fin. Okay? The theorem that we prove is that if you take a higher rank simple Lie group, you take with symmetric space X, then if you take any sequence of lattices, uniform, non-uniform, you name it, any sequence of lattices, then the corresponding quotient spaces will converge to X. Okay? So from most points, of course, if it's a non-uniform lattice, then the quotient space will have these cusps where it's very thin, but those will diminish in volume, in Haar measure. Okay? So for every R, the R-fin part diminishes in measure for any sequence. Doesn't have to be a covering tower. These lattices don't have to do anything with each other. They don't have to be commensurable or anything. Okay? That's the theorem. And it really tells you that, you know, these guys are kind of fat at most places. They have big injectivity radius. They are not just big. So of course, this is not true in rank one, right? And you see this. For example, if you take a lattice with an infinite cyclic quotient, right, then you can take the, you can walk down on that cyclic quotient, and you get bigger and bigger donuts, right? You get bigger and bigger donuts. The injectivity radius stays bounded. It's thin everywhere, but the volume tends to infinity. If you have a large lattice, a lattice that surjects on a free group, then you can do whatever you want, really, there. I mean, you can take any kind of models you want to build. Okay? So in rank one, this is very much not true, or in general, it's not true. But in higher rank, this is the general theorem. And that's it. That actually follows from the Nevos-Tuck-Zimmer theorem. Okay? So let me just add here, because I don't want to go into this. If you take a fixed arithmetic lattice, this is also part of the Seven Samurai work, if you take a fixed lattice, arithmetic lattice, and you take a sequence, not chain, a sequence of congruent subgroups, then we have explicit bounds on the size of the thin part, R-fin part, and we have explicit bounds on what is the typical injectivity radius is. So we can logarithmic in the volume, and yeah, the power of the volume in that sense. What you would get for a random graph, actually. So it really mimics the behavior of a random deregular graph. That's what happens. So this was kind of known for covering towers, like congruence, principal congruence covers, and it's much easier, of course. You can play with the arithmetic. That's part of the paper. This is arithmetic. It uses the Lie algebra methods, this proof. So anyways, let's go back. So the real theorem behind this, fatness thing, is that if you take a higher rank simple Lie group, and then for any sequence of lattices, the corresponding IRS-es will weakly converge to the trivial IRS. That's the real result. Okay? And I prove it to you now. Okay? The only thing that you have to believe it for that is that this translation from Benjamini-Schramm convergence to weak convergence works, because I never showed this to you, but just believe it. Okay, so now I prove it to you. So take a subsequential limit. Okay, well, that subsequential limit is a weak limit of lattice IRS-es. Those lattice IRS-es have spectral gap because the group has property T. If you take a sequence of measures with spectral gap, then the weak limit still has spectral gap. In particular, it's ergodic. So the weak limit of these IRS-es is ergodic. Hence, it's either the trivial group, in which case we are happy and go home, or it's the full G, which is absurd, and you can kill it very easily, or it's one of your lattices. So you would get that you have an infinite sequence of lattices, and the corresponding IRS-es weakly converge to a fixed volume lattice. Okay? But this is very easy to kill if you believe that Benjamini-Schramm sampling stuff. This would mean that if you look at a late model, a deep gamma n, you look at this quotient manifold, then from a random place, you know, in a big radius, it would look like your fixed volume manifold. Which means that it would basically look like this. But then it cannot have spectral gap. This kills the Cheeger constant immediately. So, okay? So that's a kind of back and forth geometry proof.
For congruent subgroups, this is worse than rank one.
Yes, it is true, and it's a cute argument. No, you have a soft air proof.
You have what?
That's another proof. So for.
Modulo the previous result, as you say.
Yes. Yes, yes, modulo the previous. It's true for congruence, and you can actually get explicit things. But there is a soft argument for congruence subgroups. There is a, if you have strong approximation for the lattice, then for the ambient lattice, you have strong approximation. Then there is a softer, acute stuff, softer argument. I don't have time to cover it, but maybe at the end. Okay, so this is one of the corollaries. There are many results in that paper. I just chose one that I like. This is a limit multiplicity theorem. So take a uniformly discrete sequence of lattices in G. Uniformly discrete means that the injectivity radius is bounded away from zero. In particular, they are co-compact. Okay? You don't want to deal with very thin places, and you don't want to because we don't know how to. And then the result says that if you take anything in the unitary dual, you take an irreducible representation of G, and you count its multiplicity in G mod gamma n. G mod gamma n, it's a co-compact lattice, so G mod gamma n decomposes to the sum of unitary representations, I mean L2 G mod gamma n, and you look at the multiplicity of this fixed representation there, you normalize by the volume, then it will converge, and it will converge to the multiplicity in... That's a typo. That's simply L2 of G there. Yeah, thank you. It's the Poincaré measure. Okay? So, thanks.
G type, G is simple,
any simple? G is, the way I say it now, G is simple. And there are semi-simple where you have to be a bit more careful, and I didn't want to go into all that, you know. Not higher rank at this. Higher rank here. And in rank one, you have to assume that it converges to one because it doesn't always converge to one, and then, of course, it's rubbish. So, yeah. So, okay. So, it also implies a weak convergence of the Poincaré measure. So, you can turn this into a measure. If you take L2 of gamma mod G, G mod gamma, then, you know, it decomposes, and you can, that's a measure on G hat, right? And you can normalize by the covolume, you turn it into a measure on G hat. And it turns out that these measures converge. And I'm lying now, and I don't want to go into it why I'm lying. This is only true in a factor object of the unitary dual. I'm not going there. Anyways, they converge in a strong enough sense. Okay? Weakly converge those measures. And these were known theorems. The limit multiplicity theorem was proved by DeGeorge and Wallach. And the weak convergence was proved by Delorme. For chains of subgroups, maybe normal chains, right? Yeah, normal chains of subgroups. There are lots of deep paper series. If I wanted to do name tossing, I would toss a lot of names up here, and I would like to do. I just didn't have time to write it all up. So, anyways, whatever. Lots of really deep papers here, and I just want to mention the recent work on non-uniform lattices. This is by Finnis, Lapid, and Müller. So, it's a nice piece of work. okay, so that's what you get. Same spirit again. You know, Benjamini-Schramm convergence implies spectral convergence. Just by spectra, we mean unitary representation theory now. Okay, so there is a very nice aside here, which is called character rigidity. And I just want to put this up there. I want you to stare at it. Maybe I say a word, and then I go, and maybe I come back. It's very exciting. I don't think we have much time for it. So actually, if you can define character theory of these infinite discrete groups, a character is a conjugacy invariant normalized positive definite function, complex function. And you know, it was the early champion of this was Toma and also Kirillov. And Verschik proved that if you take an IRS, then the probability that G is in the IRS is a character. Okay? So that's nothing else but what you already know in finite representation theory. This is the permutation character, the set of fixed points, the measure of fixed points. Okay, that's a character. It's a character here. And then you can build character theory and you can say meaningful things. So there is a beautiful theorem of Becker. Who proves character rigidity for SLNZ, It says that every character of every irreducible character of SLN Z either comes from a finite index subgroup or it comes from the center. Okay? This immediately implies the IRS rigidity. Because for every IRS, you can take the corresponding character. And you know, if there are no characters, there are no IRS's. So this is one of the directions which is not yet fully explored. What is the, is there something backwards? You know, is it true that if you have few IRS's, then you also have few characters? You know, certainly things point that way, but there is no theory. In finite group theory, there is some stuff. So the corresponding theory kind of exists for finite groups. And then there are hardcore theorems out there, and I'm not going there. Kreutz and Kreutz-Peterson. There is a beautiful paper by Peterson and Tom where they prove character rigidity for various classes of groups. So, okay. Okay, let's get to open problems. I managed to reach open problems, and I still have... Really? I still have minus 3 minutes. That's great. I'm not supposed to ask whether I can continue, right?
Yeah, I give you 3 minutes.
Okay. It's just 3 pages, so it's 3 minutes. Okay. The first question, rank one simple Lie groups. What can you say about convergence there? First question, we also asked this question, Sarnak also asked this question. Take any sequence of congruence lattices, non-commensurable. Even in rank one, they should converge to one. Okay, this is proved by Rambeau in a special case for Bianchi groups, you know, SL2z square root of minus d, d tends to infinity, beautiful paper, proves much more there actually, don't have time to talk about it. And then you can look at, you can say that the lattice is Ramanujan if, you know, if it's spectra, if the bottom of Laplacian is at most the bottom of Laplacian of the universal cover. Okay, there is the Zellberg conjectures, the Ramanujan conjectures, you know about this. So in this category, we proved with Balint-Virag that if you take a sequence of best expanded lattices, then they must converge. This is also a Kesten theorem, if you want. Same spirit. Okay, they must converge to the trivial one. Then there is this fact that random deregular graphs converge to the deregular tree. So this made Shmuel Weinberger ask, if you take a Lie group where there are only finitely many lattices up to conjugacy of volume less than n for every n, is it true that random lattices must converge to one? There is a discrete version. I don't know any counterexamples for that. It's very fresh. Same for residually finite discrete groups. Take a residually finite discrete group. Take a random subgroup of index at most n. Is it true that the IRS converges to 1? For the free group, this is just a reformulation for random deregular graphs. Same stuff. So it follows for the free group. Next thing, growth of the rank. Okay. So I'm keeping that because Nick already talked about this. The general question is whether the rank is testable in that, you know, continuous in that IRS. So that would imply that in a higher rank simple Lie group, the rank grows sublinearly in the volume for any sequence of lattices. Okay, I'm skipping that. I'm skipping that because it's measured groupoids and that's more than 2 minutes. And I definitely skip this. Sorry, guys. It's good stuff. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. So some short questions.
I have a short question. Any names?
Any names?
No. Well, you can come to me, you know, at the break.
Happy.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
All right.
So thank you again, and again, happy birthday to you.
Oh, thank you.